rehabilitation in COVID-19 patients. So I would have loved to go to Sikkim and present my talk, but the sole reason why I'm delivering my speech from this hot and humid Kolkata is the COVID-19 pandemic, which is an unprecedented challenge to mankind and the healthcare system. So we all are learning a new chapter in medical science. Even me, after 15 years of passing my MBBS, I'm learning a new chapter, but our learning curve is very steep. So there are potential risks and hurdles in COVID-19 management as well as rehabilitation, but we are learning the strategies to overcome them. So I will mainly follow the revised guideline by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, which was published on 28th of April 2021 and the World Health Organization guidelines. So spectrum of COVID-19 disease, it can be from asymptomatic to severe or critical illness. The disease can evolve from mild, moderate to severe at any moment of time. So we should be very cautious of, while handling the COVID-19 patient. We'll restrict our discussion mainly to the asymptomatic and mild cases of COVID-19, how they can be managed at home environment. Let us first know who are the asymptomatic cases. They are the RT-PCR confirmed cases not experiencing any symptoms and having oxygen saturation at room air at more than 94%. And mild cases are patients who having respiratory symptoms and or fever without shortness of breath and having saturation at room air of more than 94%. They may have other symptoms like anosmia, loss of taste, agresia, that is loss of anosmia, that is loss of smell, agresia, that is loss of taste. They may be diarrhea, weakness, muscle soreness, myalgia, etc. We must know who are the eligible patients. Only the mild symptoms or the asymptomatic laboratory confirmed, and they should be assigned on physician, not by patients. And patients should be with comorbidity and less than of age. It was there in the previous guidelines, but the new revised guidelines says that elderly patients are over 60 years of age, and those with comorbid patients can also well, home isolation, like those patients who are having hypertension, diabetes, heart disease, chronic lung, liver, or kidney disease, but only after proper evaluation by the treating medical officer. Same applies for the patients with immunocompromised status, like HIV, transplant recipients, cancer therapy patients, etc. So the home isolation patient should have adequate facility for self-isolation, preferably in a separate room in their house with an attached toilet at the residence, and also there may be facility for quarantine of the family contacts. Patients should be under a qualified doctor who is available for teleconsultation. Caregivers should also be available when patients need to monitor health by himself, and the patient and caregiver regularly inform the patient's status to a doctor by or other follow-up. So, if possible, they should also monitor the tablet levels, serum creatinine, ECG, etc. Now, coming to the management at home, patients should be educated about use of masks, hand hygiene, physical distancing, and proper precautions. Ivermectin 12 mg once daily can be used for 3 to 5 days, along with doxycycline 100 mg twice daily for 7 days. Paracetamol can be used for fever as well as cases. Within C 500 mg twice daily and zinc 50 mg per day should be given to the patient. Laxative if necessary, supportive treatment for cough with antipsychotic, antiagnostic, with tea and probiotics. Steroids should not be used routinely in patients with mild disease, but can be used if the fever persists for more than 7 days after consultation with the treating physician. And inhalation budesonide can also be used at home if the treating physician advises so. So the instruction we should give to the patient: patient must isolate himself from the other household members and stay in that identified room and away from the other people in the home, especially elderly and those who are having comorbid conditions. And patient should be kept in a well ventilated room with cross ventilation windows, should be kept open all the time. Patients should wear triple-layer medical masks and discard each mask after 8 hours and if they become soiled earlier. If the caregiver enters the room, the caregiver and the patient should consider using N95 mask. Masks should always be discarded after disinfecting with 1% sodium hydrochloride. Patients should always take, always maintain proper hydration and nutrition and should take adequate rest. They should follow respiratory etiquette all the time, frequent hand washing with soap and water for 40 seconds, and they can clean their hands with alcohol-based sanitizers. They should not share their personal items with other people in the household. They should ensure cleaning the surfaces of the room with 1% hydrochloride solutions, especially the tabletops, doorknobs, and handles, which are frequently touched. Self-monitoring of blood oxygen saturation with a pulse oximeter is strongly recommended. And patients should self-monitor his or her health and should promptly report back to the health facility if any deterioration of symptoms is noticed. Now, caregivers should be educated on the use of the mask. Like the caregiver should wear a triple-layer medical mask or the N95 mask when they're living in the same room with the patients. They should not touch the front portion of the mask. If the mask is wet, they should discard it immediately. And after discarding the mask, it is advisable to practice hand hygiene, and they should avoid touching own face, nose, or mouth. The guidelines for proper hand hygiene should be told to the relatives. Like hand hygiene should be maintained while he or she is in contact. So hand hygiene must be ensured in contact with the immediate environment. Hands should also be practiced before and after taking food for the patient, repeatedly after using the toilet and whenever the hands look dirty. Soap and water can be used for 40 seconds, or alcohol-based hand sanitizers can be used only when the hands are not visibly soiled. After using soap and water, this is advisable to use disposable paper towels to dry the hands if not available. Cleaning cloth towels can be used. They have to be replaced once they become wet. So after using the gloves, if we were removing the gloves, it is better to perform hand hygiene after that. If the patient is the relatives are in direct contact with the patient's environment, they should avoid at least direct contact with the body parts of the patients, particularly the oral or respiratory secretions, and should always wear disposable gloves while handling the patients. They should avoid exposure to the potentially contaminated items. They should not share cigarettes, eating in the same utensils should be avoided. Bins should not be shared, and towels and bed linen should also not be shared. Food must be provided to the patient's own room. Utensils and dishes should be cleaned with soap and detergent, and washing utensils, caregiver must wear gloves and dishes may be used. As I have already mentioned that after the gloves, we should always on your hand. And effective rest is very important to prevent further spread infection within the household. So when we need to take family members, they should under the COVID test whenever they are symptomatic, or they should under the COVID testing within 5 to 10 days of exposure, or if they're having any high risk factors, or was or is in the flu active. Then patients should also be warned, should they discontinue the home isolation, that is after 17 days from the onset of symptoms, where the patient is at a bed for at least 10 days. Or after 17 days from the sampling of the symptomatic, there is no repeat test after the home isolation is over. That is frequently asked by the patients and should patient infection be taken? If SpO2 was 95% in care, the disappearance contained within the highest persistent for 7 days. Symptoms of fever after retention of base patient chest pain or chest was stopped. At least more than 5 times of the suffering level is correctly. 2 times of the limit of normal neutralization patient 0.1 or treating resistant is in. What are the high risk factors? Let's see the age of the patient, the TSP is having chronic lung, hypertension, or any other disease, diabetes, HIV, cannot receive any drugs. A brief discussion about the mild cases in children. The symptoms may be fever, sore throat, rhinorrhea, cough, diarrhea, vomiting, but there should not be any first feeding. First feeding is qualified to moderate or severe disease. And they can be managed at home by home isolation and supportive care. They should take adequate rest and hydration. Feeding should continue. Antibiotics are not recommended routinely in pediatric patients. Paracetamol can be used for the 10 to 15 milligram per kg body weight for fever. And the parents should report to the healthcare facility if in case of any worsening. COVID-19 vaccination. Patients and relatives often ask that I'm suffering from COVID-19, when should I get vaccinated? So the answer is very clear. It should be deferred for 4 to 8 weeks after recovery, and it is not currently recommended for pregnant and lactating women or children less than 18 years of age. Now coming to the second part of our discussion, that is rehabilitation consideration in COVID-19 patients. Rehabilitation should commence in the acute stage, where our objectives are to maximize oxygenation of the lungs, manage secretions, and prevent complication. In the post-acute or subacute phase, we try to identify and manage the impairments early and facilitate safe discharge from the hospital. In the long-term basis, we try to optimize functioning and independence of the patient and maximize his quality of life. So rehab is not done only by the rehab physician. It is, of course, a team game where the team consists of physiotherapists, occupational therapists, audiologists, speech, language, and swallowing pathologists, orthopedists and prosthetists, we have psychologists, we have nurses, we have health assistants, vocational counselors, social workers, etc. So they all are needed for post-COVID rehabilitation. Let us see what are the impairments that can be associated with COVID-19 disease. They may impair lung function, they may be physical deconditioning, impairment of speech and swallowing and communication, cognitive impairment, and psychological issues may be there, difficulties in managing ADL and post-COVID fatigue may be there. So patients with severe disease and critical illness may also suffer from facial injuries, polymyalgopathy, incontinence of bladder bowel, metabolic derangement, disuse, atrophy of the muscles, etc. So first we should screen the patient, and then a comprehensive assessment should be done. Then rehabilitation planning should be done by the rehab physician. Interventions are given to the patient. Patients should be constantly monitored, and then again reassessed and replanned. So this is the rehabilitation cycle described by the WHO. Rehabilitation planning is always patient-centered and goal-oriented. And we follow a step-down approach. We start the rehabilitation in the inpatient settings, and then we continue it in the outpatient basis, and then we translate the rehabilitation to the community rehab. So what are the scopes of rehabilitation in COVID-19? We can give them exercises, but that is not all. Patient education and nutritional advices are very important. We can give them assistive devices to help them in their activities of daily living. Caregiver support and education is very much important. Peer group support and counseling is very much required. Stress management and psychological counseling can help the patient a lot. Home medication may be required in some cases. And treatment of complications is, of course, the responsibility of the rehab physician. So what are the challenges in COVID-19 rehabilitation? Many of the states of India are facing lockdown till now. So there may be absence of well-coordinated care for the patient. Due to lack of transport, the patient may not be able to come to the health facility. So there may be lots of follow-up. There is lack of resources and resource personnel. There is fear of spread of COVID-19 infection. So patient may not get back to the healthcare facility. So many hurdles. What strategies we can adopt for that? Tele-rehabilitation is one answer where we can give rehabilitation advices to the patient using video conferencing. And we can also provide the patient with educational resources, information booklets, or to support self-management, like WHO and NHS has come up with their own patient information booklets. They must be very helpful for the patients. Now coming to the impairments one by one, management of impaired lung function. So what are the causes of impaired lung function? There may be viral respiratory syndrome, which is complicated by pneumonia, pulmonary thromboembolism, pulmonary fibrosis, respiratory muscle weakness, can cause lung impairment. So what are the indicators of impairment? There may be persistent dry cough, breathlessness, chest pain, or tightness. There may be wheezing. So what are the targets of pulmonary rehabilitation in COVID-19 patients? We first try to increase the ventilation. We try to through the airway clearance where indicated, educating the patient about breathlessness and how to manage it by their own physical exercises and fitness, returning to everyday activities and nutritional support. We'll discuss these issues one by one. This is a self-explanatory picture where we can see how prone lying can help the patient to increase the oxygenation of the lungs. And active cycle breathing technique is also very important to facilitate the respiratory muscles. These are the exercises that increase breathing control and support deep breathing with thoracic expansion to improve ventilation of the lower lung areas. Here, the patient takes a deep breath, then a breath holding. Then we can take a big short huff, that is, or a small long huff. A big short huff is to move the phlegm from higher up in the lungs, and the small long huff, this is to move the phlegm from lower down the chest to higher up. So this will help the patient to clear their secretions. And these are some postures where to alleviate the breathlessness in the patient. You can use a high sideline posture, forward lean sitting with or without the table, forward lean standing, and standing with back support. Now coming to incentive spirometry, which is very helpful to regain the lung function and control breathing techniques where the patient can inhale through the nose and exhale through the mouth deeply. And two more popular techniques are there, like first lip breathing and square box breathing, where patient has to close his eyes and imagine that he's exhaling, inhaling and exhaling sequentially. And other exercises should be taught to the patient, and patient should be well monitored so that if the condition deteriorates, they must report to the health facilities. Now coming to the management of physical deconditioning, who are the patients at risk? Patients who are critically ill with prolonged hospital stay, mechanically ventilated patients, those patients who were on prolonged oxygen therapy, elderly patients, and patients with complex clinical situations with comorbidities. Even patients who are managed at home may experience physical deconditioning if the deconditioning persists more than 6 to 8 weeks from the onset of illness, rehabilitation consultation is indicated. So what can be the etiology of this physical deconditioning? It may be due to immobility from prolonged bed rest, which induces muscle atrophy. Muscle atrophy can occur as a side effect of some drugs like steroids, neuromuscular blocking agents. Critical illness, polymyelinopathy can cause muscle weakness. Inflammation of the peripheral nervous system, metabolic arrangements like hyperglycemia and malnutrition can accentuate the condition. So what are our objectives to improve this condition? To improve physical function, to compensate for physical deficit, empower the patient and their family to understand the impairment and how to manage within their daily lives. So first we have to assess the patient, we have to assess their muscle strength, range of motion of the joint, exercise tolerance with step stairs and sit to stand stairs. Balancing, coordination, functional mobility should be assessed, observing the transfer in and out of the bed, walking up the stairs, etc. Glucose monitoring for desaturation should be done during the assessment. So, what are the interventions? Of course, we'll start with early mobilization of the patient, even in ICU. We'll start with bed mobility, bed exercises, sitting out of the bed in the supportive chair, sit to stand, standing with support. And if facilities are available, we can take the patient to the chair table. Education regarding breathlessness and fatigue is very important. And as we have already discussed, the positions that patients should adopt while being breathless. And also, they should be educated regarding resuming their everyday activities at an appropriate pace that is safe and manageable for this energy level. Physical exercises we'll discuss in details to regain fitness. Provision of assistive devices can be done by the occupational therapist, and proper nutrition and avoidance of smoking. As we all know, smoking is a great damager of the lungs. And proper nutrition helps to regain patient the health. We actually tell the patient you eat a rainbow. You eat colorful vegetables like green leafy vegetables, any colorful fruits, yellow, red, whatever you like. Take a handful of portion of protein, a very good amount of protein should be there in their diet, and whatever they taste like. So that will be very helpful for them. So now coming to the muscle stability exercises, very common exercises that can that the patient can do at their homes, like bicep curls, wall push-up, abduction, sit to stand, knee straightening, squats, knee raises, marching on squat, and step-ups. So the general recommendations for exercising is the patient should aim to do exercises for 20 to 30 minutes, 5 days per week, and they should start with less exercises and increase slowly by 30 seconds to 1 minute each time. Warm up and cool down sessions before and after the exercise is very important. Home exercises should be provided to the patient in view of the pandemic situation. They should keep an exercise logbook with them. They should use pulse oximeter to monitor the oxygen saturation during exercising. And they should immediately stop exercising if the saturation drops more than 5-10% during the exercise. So now we are coming to the management of swallowing and communication impairment. So what are the etiologies of swallowing impairment? Let us see. There may be tissue changes in the oral and nasopharyngeal cavities. There may be weakening of the swallowing mechanisms, diminished swallowing reflexes and muscle tone, changes in the viscosity of the saliva, cognitive impairment can also affect swallowing. So it can manifest as aspiration, which may present as frequent coughing and choking while eating or drinking, but it can be silent also, especially in neurological impaired patients. And there may be nasal regurgitation, dysphagia, that is painful swallowing. There may be decreased food and liquid intake, and patient may experience weight loss. So assessment for swallowing should always be done by a qualified swallowing pathologist. Evaluation, we can do dynamic imaging using modified barium swallow test, that is MBSS. And in our department, we are using fiber optic endoscopic evaluation for swallowing. Then intervention, we should always educate the patients first that they should always take liquids and solids in upright position while eating or drinking, and modify the consistency of the food may be helpful because there is greater chance of aspiration with thinner liquids. Fluoride food tend to be safer and easier to swallow than chalk food. So fluoride food and thickened liquids are often tried first. Oral child should be deferred for at least 24 hours post-intubation. And they should, they can also follow some chin tuck technique, effective swallow that can push the food to the esophagus. And they should eat in a quiet environment. There should be slow intake of food. They should not rush while eating. And they should take all the food and liquids in small portions. They can alternate food and liquids. And they should, of course, maintain oral hygiene by brushing their teeth, cleaning the mouth with water after having food. They can use mouthwashes and dental floss, etc. So they should also practice breathing exercises like with a resistant trainer, voice exercises which include singing, chanting, and sighing, but they should not do whispering or yelling. Eating and drinking exercises should also be practiced, like chewing and swallowing as effectively as possible, by using the thickest food and liquid the patient can tolerate. So strategies for safe eating and drinking should be taught to the family members, and they should always observe for symptoms of aspirations like changes in the breathing pattern if the patient is gasping. There is watery eyes, red voice, coughing and choking, etc. They should also always report back to the doctor. Now coming to communication impairment. It can be due to various reasons like obstruction in the oral cavity, nasal cavity, and or pharynx. Tissue changes in the oral cavity, nasal cavity, pharynx associated with intubation, tracheostomy, weakening of the articulators, muscle atrophy due to disuse or medication side effects. Cognitive impairment can also affect communication. So what are the key strategies in managing communication impairment? In intubated patients, we should encourage using communication board and devices. Patients who are having tracheostomy, we can use speech valves from them And post-intubation patients should practice using their voice gently and mental ear hygiene as discussed earlier. So focus should be on the patient's communication strength and support meaningful communication. And caregivers should be counseled not to talk for their loved ones. And they should be explained about the impact of fatigue on communication, and they should take rest frequently and avoid speaking in their environment with background noise. So, and patients should always be instructed to practice their voice gently through singing, reading, conversation, and they should avoid whispering and speaking loudly that affects the vocal cord. They should refrain themselves from smoking, and they should stay hydrated and maintain vocal hygiene. And now we are coming to cognitive and psychological impairments. So what are the etiologies we can see? There may be neuroinflammation, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, sepsis associated encephalopathy, drug-induced psychosis, confusion, hallucinations, or if there was a pre-existing cognitive impairment that can be exacerbated in patients suffering from COVID-19. It can manifest as memory loss, disorientation, reduced attention and concentration, easy distraction, impairment of planning, problem-solving, decision-making, and judgment. Patient experience severe fatigue, mood changes, anxiety and depression, and sleep deprivation. So cognitive assessment should be carried out in a quiet and comfortable environment. And whatever information you can take, like patient should be instructed to do the physical exercises regularly. Cognitive activities should be given to them, like puzzles, word games, and memory games, etc. They should start with the activities that are challenging but achievable. And then gradually we increase the difficulty level so to keep the patient motivated. And they should also take part in their ideas. We should give them tools to compensatory strategies, like they should use some prompts like leads, notes, alerts, and alarms. They should break down the activities into the simple ones, and they should also practice relaxation like meditation and all. And education of the patient and caregiver is very much important. Now coming to the ADL management, which is mostly the domain of the occupational therapist, we can see the causes of impaired performance in ADL. There may be impaired lung function, deconditioning, reduced mobility, fatigue, cognitive impairment, all can hamper the ADL activities of the patient. So our goal should be increasing the safety while performing the ADL, increasing the patient's independence, and improve his or her quality of life. So the key strategies taken are energy conservation technique, and the occupational therapists, they follow the day-long activities of the patient, and they give a patient schedule chart how they can conserve their energy. And the patient should have realistic expectations. They should not expect, I'll do all my hard work. And they should accept help from others. They should return to their full activities gradually. Occupational therapists can give them some assistive device that can ease their tasks. Sometimes home modifications are required, like if they arrange the things at their reach, so they don't have to reach to the top of the racks and all. And patient education and addressing individual challenges should be done after discussion with the rehab physician and the occupational therapist. Post-COVID fatigue management has become very important, like what are the steps we can follow. The patients should get adequate rest and sleep, relaxation techniques like listening to the music, meditation and all, proper nutrition and hydration, as we have already discussed, planning and programming of the activities. Patients should try doing the activities, keep the activities low initially. They should slowly increase the activity level, and they should alternate periods of activity and rest. So they should not do all the heavy activities at a stretch. They should alternate the heavy and light activities also. So they should practice pacing even to walk. They should not start walking all day long.
Hello?
They should not start walking all day long. And entertainment should be there. They should watch TV, whatever music they like. that will also alleviate some amount of that. So to conclude, provision of rehabilitation should occur along the continuum of care of COVID-19 patient. Infection prevention control measures may influence service delivery, but measures can be taken to adapt and continue services. Tele-rehabilitation may be the cornerstone in COVID-19 rehabilitation. We at IMK are carrying out daily rehabilitation services for the last 1 year, and we hope to continue this in coming days. Together, we shall overcome this pandemic. Thank you for your patience with me.
Thank you, ma'am. We are thankful to you, ma'am. That was indeed a very wonderful session. Now, मैं हमारे पार्टिसिपेंट को रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा अगर आपका कोई क्वेश्चन है आप डायरेक्टली रिसर्च पर्सन को पूछ सकते हैं
गुड मॉर्निंग myself ma'am in one of years why do you mentioned about the tele rehabilitation for yes. covid patients yes. I want to know from you which mode of the tele rehabilitation is best for our covid patient living in the rural areas or the remote areas
like even in the rural areas patients are having a smartphone nowadays so yes. in our institution we are using whatsapp as a medium we make simple whatsapp calls and connect them by video conferencing and we give them consultation of the physicians or we give them the therapist advice through that WhatsApp video call. We do not use any sophisticated software or any other app for the telerehabilitation.
Okay ma'am, okay. Asynchronous mode is also useful for ma'am as the patients are totally unaware about the technology living in the rural areas and we know that the COVID is spreading in the rural areas yeah. and how they can avail the services of this the tele in their village such kind of areas ma'am.
In that case we can record some videos and send them to the patients like if they are not being able to connect directly through the video conferencing. We can send them pre-recorded videos. We can give our advices over phone. That is also a more feasible option.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Hello, ma'am. This is Rakesh here. हमारे पार्टिसिपेंट पूछते हैं कि अगर कोई कोविड पॉजिटिव होता है देन कितने दिन के बाद वो वैक्सीन ले सकते हैं
Yes, I have already discussed it in my slide that COVID vaccination should be deferred 4 to 8 weeks after the positive report. So it is safe to take after 1 to 2 months, not during the acute illness. In fact, any hospitalized patient, any acutely patient should not receive the COVID vaccine as per government recommendation. They should at least wait for 4 weeks after in the convalescence phase they can take the vaccine.
थैंक यू मैम देन मैम और एक पार्टिसिपेंट का क्वेश्चन है अगर कोई जैसे कि दो वैक्सीन अवेलेबल है कोवैक्सीन एंड कोविशील्ड सो अल्टरनेट वैक्सीन ले सकते हैं जैसे फर्स्ट डोज अगर कोई लेते हैं कोविशील्ड देन कोवैक्सीन ले सकते हैं या नहीं
नो इट इज नॉट रिकमेंडेड राकेश गवर्नमेंट सेज दैट इफ यू आर टेकिंग कोविशील्ड यू हैव टू टेक द सेकंड डोज ऑफ कोविशील्ड ओनली एंड इफ यू हैव टेकन टू वैक्सीन सो यू आर फ्री
Thank you, ma'am. This was really a wonderful session. Now, I'd like to request Mr. Vidya Bhushan sir, lecturer of physiotherapy, CRC Sikkim. Please kindly be here and deliver the vote of thanks.
Good morning to all. मैं विद्या भूषण लेक्चरर भौतिक चिकित्सा विभाग CRC Sikkim की तरफ से धन्यवाद करने का अवसर प्रदान किया गया है उसके लिए मैं सबसे पहले राकेश महापात्रा सर को धन्यवाद देता हूं एवं धन्यवाद के क्रम में सर्वप्रथम निर्देशक महोदय NIPBD डॉक्टर हिमांशु दास सर को धन्यवाद करते हैं जिनके मार्गदर्शन एवं प्रेरणा से हम निरंतर इस तरह के कार्यक्रम को आयोजित कर पाते हैं आज का वेबिनार मैनेजमेंट ऑफ नॉन सीवियर केसेस ऑफ कोविड 19 एंड रिहैबिलिटेशन ऑफ कोविड 19 पेशेंट्स के ऊपर है जो जिसके ऊपर वेरी वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन डॉक्टर सुचिता शाह मैडम कंसल्टेंट INK के द्वारा किया गया जो कि अत्यंत लाभकारी एवं प्रैक्टिकल बेस्ड है मैडम के बताए गए सुझाव जैसे टेली मेडिसिन कोऑर्डिनेशन बिटवीन द प्रोफेशनल्स who is related to the COVID-19 patients service, like, and family education about the COVID-19 lifestyle modification. ये सारी बातों को अगर हम लोग अक्षर से फॉलो करें और पालन करेंगे तो निश्चित रूप से कोविड-19 पैंडेमिक के आत्मघाती प्रभाव से निजात पा सकते हैं. मैडम को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद कि मैडम ने आज के इस वंडरफुल सेशन को प्रेजेंटेशन किया. धन्यवाद मैम. इस वेबिनार से जुड़े हम सीआरसी सिक्किम के रेजिडेंट कोऑर्डिनेटर मैम मोरेंखेन आयरिस मैडम का धन्यवाद करते हैं जो निरंतर इस तरह के कार्यक्रम को प्रशस्त करने के लिए आसान बनाती हैं एवं मार्गदर्शन करती रहती हैं. वेबिनार के कोऑर्डिनेटर राकेश महापात्रा सर, प्रवक्ता व्यावसायिक चिकित्सा विभाग को हम धन्यवाद देते हैं जिनके प्रयास से आज का प्रोग्राम हम लोग सुचारू रूप से संचालित कर पा रहे हैं. धन्यवाद के क्रम में हम सीआरसी सिक्किम के टेक्निकल टीम मनीष कुमार, विकास कुमार एवं अपने कॉलीग्स कौशलेंद्र कुमार सर जो कि हमारे सहायक प्रोफेसर हैं स्पेशल एजुकेशन विभाग में, मैडम क्लिनिकल साइकोलॉजी मैडम रजनी मैडम हैं एवं आज के जुड़े सारे कॉलीग जो सीआरसी सिक्किम से जुड़े हुए हैं उन सभी को हम धन्यवाद करते हैं जो कि अहम भूमिका निभाए हैं आज के प्रोग्राम को संचालित करने के लिए. आज हम देख रहे हैं कि इस प्रोग्राम में बहुत अच्छे अच्छे प्रोफेशनल्स जुड़े हुए हैं. उनके क्रम में हमारे शिक्षक एवं मार्गदर्शक के रूप में विभूति सरकार सर जो कि नोडल ऑफिसर सीआरसी त्रिपुरा से हैं वो भी जुड़े हुए थे और उन्होंने भी इस प्रोग्राम आज देखा. सर को भी मैं दिल की गहराइयों से धन्यवाद करना चाहता हूँ. लास्ट बट नॉट लीस्ट मैं आज के प्रोग्राम से जुड़े सभी पार्टिसिपेंट्स प्रतिभागियों को धन्यवाद करते हैं जो अति महत्वपूर्ण है जिनके पार्टिसिपेशन से ही आज का कार्यक्रम सफलपूर्वक आयोजित हो पाया है. तो उन सारे पार्टिसिपेंट्स जो आज जुड़े हुए हैं उन सभी को दिल की गहराइयों से धन्यवाद. सीआरसी सिक्किम अपने उद्देश्यों के लिए प्रतिबद्ध है. मैं आज के जुड़े सभी प्रतिभागियों से आग्रह करता हूं कि उनके पुनर्वास सेवाओं के लिए सीआरसी हमेशा तत्पर है तो वो कभी भी रिहैबिलिटेशन सर्विसेज को लेकर अगर कोई समस्याएं हैं तो वो हमारे सीआरसी सिक्किम की संस्था में कांटेक्ट कर सकते हैं और सीआरसी सिक्किम प्रतिबद्ध है अपनी उद्देश्यों अपने मूल्यों को स्थापित करने के लिए. एक बार फिर से मैम चिता साह मैडम को धन्यवाद फॉर द वंडरफुल सेशन के लिए. धन्यवाद सभी को. नाउ आई ओवर टू राकेश महापात्रा सर, प्लीज कंटिन्यू द प्रोग्राम.
थैंक यू सर एंड थैंक यू टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स.
थैंक यू सीआरसी सिक्किम टीम, द होल टीम, वेरी वेल प्रेजेंटेड बाय मैम डॉक्टर सुचिता साह. Myself, Pradeep Pawa. Already I have question to ma'am from CRC Sundarnagar. Really, ma'am, you have discussed a lot of things about the COVID acute phase and the chronic and the post-acute phase, the management that we require, the patients require in such typical conditions. Lots of information given by you. Really wonderful presentation, ma'am. Thank you. And the team, the CRC Sikkim, once again, I am really stand happy to see you all over there at one platform. Thank you all team members. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Yes, I would also like to thank the CSE Sikkim team and for inviting me. And any help if you need from a doctor, I have come to know that there is no rehabilitation doctor in CSE Sikkim. Any help you need anytime, please contact us. We'll be happy to help you in any way. From any patient, any consultation you need, we are there with you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. मैं अभी अवसर के रूप से ये सभा को समाप्त करने के लिए घोषणा करता हूँ. थैंक यू.